The Unshackled Waves, episode 72. Hello and welcome to the Unshackled Waves podcast. I'm Tim Wilms, here for this week's review episode, and I'm joined once again by my co-editor-in-chief of The Unshackled, Sukhith Fernando. Welcome again.
Thanks, Tim, and hello, everyone.
Now, some good news. The new studio has now been fitted, so there'll be no more echoes during the podcast, so everything is back to normal, and we'll be able to bring you a lot more episodes, which is exciting. The news of the week in Australian politics was that the New South Wales Liberal Party, they passed what was called the Warringah Motion, which was spearheaded by former Prime Minister Tony Abbott to allow for that state to pre-select candidates via plebiscite of members. It's an important reform to make sure that the Liberal Party allows its grassroots members to have a greater say, and it will stop people or slow down the disillusionment some Conservatives have with the party who are going over to One Nation and Australian Conservatives. Labor leader Bill Shorten, he launched his war on inequality last week. His election agenda seems to be to tax our way to prosperity and spend as much as possible, which is quite concerning. Donald Trump also celebrated the first 6 months of his presidency. He's done the best he can under the circumstances. He's still being thwarted, not just by Democrats, but by members of his own party. There's still more to be done. Also, what's been in the news the last few months, I'd say, is the leftist AFL is pretty much now out of control. Every round now appears to be a social justice round. Last week it was gay pride round, and now this week it's multicultural round. And let's not forget all the various scandals that it's had with its executives playing up. But we'll start with the New South Wales Liberal Party reform. So the state Liberals in New South Wales, they had their state conference. So it was called the Warringah Motion. It passed, but it still has to be ratified by Liberal Party State Council. This is all very confusing. There's a conference and a council. If you're not in the Liberal Party, it's all very difficult to know what everything's called. But at the moment, pre-selections are decided by a delegate system, which basically means it's the factional power brokers which decide who are the candidates. And at the moment, it's the left of the Liberal Party which has control, which is why Liberal Party is losing a lot of Conservatives in that state. So it's definitely a needed reform and actually brings New South Wales into line with the rest of the state Liberal parties.
Yeah, I think I actually like this reform because I think it reflects, I think, the sort of populist trend I think we've been seeing for quite some time over the past few years. So I think, you know, Tony Abbott was on the side where they were fighting for the plebiscite, and it's funny, it's interesting because the right, the conservative faction was towards, they supported the plebiscite, and the actual left faction, they opposed the plebiscite. I thought that was quite interesting, considering how, you know, people usually have the impression that it's the other way around for some reason, but it's not. You know, Tony Abbott was welcoming of the change, and I'm welcoming of this change, because I think the Liberal Party sort of has had this sort of reputation or an image where it looks like some, you know, a sort of a very exclusive sort of, you know, club for people. And I think that has resulted in one way or another, has resulted over the ages, you know, sort of estranged the party from particular demographics. You know, I understand that the left faction has been doing that recently. Malcolm Turnbull has done more for the estrangement than that particular aspect of their reputation. But that's more of a recent thing. This is more of something that has happened over the ages. And I think this change is good in the sense that it can help them appeal to the general public and sort of, you know, get appeal to people who wouldn't generally vote for the Liberals.
I mean, let's have a look at some of the MPs that the current New South Wales factional system has helped elect. I mean, Trent Zimmerman in North Sydney, he was put there by a factional deal. The just recent North Shore by-election with her name's Felicity Wilson. She doesn't know where she went to university or where she lived or what electorate she's voted in. She's pretty clueless.
Yeah, I think that's just one sort of that's the consequence you get from having an overly sort of authoritarian procedure to getting people the faction that is in control that now is a left wing faction. They can choose whoever they want to actually get into the party without much of a contribution from other people in the party. So allowing a plebiscite hopefully can actually get solve these problems where they choose whoever they want and can actually take people who are competent, instead of doing the thing that's been happening right, or continuing on with what's happening right now, and just taking in people who are socially progressive, who they think would be able to appeal to the majority of Australians because they have a flawed perception of what Australia is. They think it's socially progressive, but there are many people who are conservative. So let's hope that this plebiscite will let them choose the proper suitable candidates in the future.
And yeah, the state council, I think they'd have a real nerve to vote it down, especially since it was
Yeah.
carried overwhelmingly at the
It
conference.
was. Yeah, it was. I think it was six, I think it was 61% who did vote in the first who voted for it in the first motion, I think it was. If they do if they did sort of repeal it, or they don't let it happen, then I think it's going to result in some sort of backlash. I know Ross Cameron was quite vocal about this entire episode right now. He was saying that the party is meant to be for the people, and if the left faction are going to prevent the people from having any influence on the party and are just going to keep being sort of these exclusive people, exclusive elite, culturally elite people who sort of are unable to appeal to the rest of Australians, Cameron said that that's going to result in the party further going backwards, and hopefully the state council actually does something that is constructive and actually lets this thing pass on.
Well, the reasons that are given against these reforms, well, or should I say the official reasons, is that having plebiscites, it leads to branch stacking and more extreme candidates, and they point to what's happening in my state of Victoria, where Marcus Bastion, one of the up-and-coming Liberal Party members, has recruited a whole lot of new conservatives to the party, and people have accused him of branch stacking and bringing in extreme candidates. But I actually, like more extreme candidates. I think that's good because at least they, stand for something.
Yeah, I think I obviously like having more conservative candidates. I mean, the Liberal Party is meant to be a conservative party, so having extreme candidates is a good thing in today's context. But I think for Victoria, I guess it's a bit of a different story. I'm just hoping in New South Wales, where the party has been described as a gay club by some people, or some as I mentioned, some sort of exclusive inner city sort of leftist club where they're estranged from everyone else. I think I hope this change does bring a more fair element. I think the left has been able to, in the party, the left faction in the party has been able to take advantage of this, the formal procedure, and sort of take in anyone they want. And I hope this procedure can help them to actually, allow other members of the party, other right-wing members who probably don't have a voice, to actually influence who they take in as candidates in the next election, and hopefully help the party survive in the future.
When people say extreme candidates, they mean that candidates they don't like or the media doesn't
Yeah,
like.
exactly. That's the thing. That's why we like having those candidates, because those candidates are the proper candidates. It's just given the context right now, they are the extreme ones. I think since, as you mentioned, the media as well. Since the media is also powerful, I think that is also a major factor that influences these leftist, these leftist sort of elites within the party to take in people who they think are socially progressive, or socially liberal or whatever, well, small illiberal or whatever. And I think if they do have this more democratic procedure, this plebiscite procedure, then I think they can ignore the media and sort of prevent the media from indirectly sort of influencing and infiltrating into the system, and actually make a more logical and a more democratic decision as to who gets into the party.
I mean, part of the reason why Trump could never happen in Australia is because we don't have a primary system like the United States does. I mean, the American system, it's completely democratic, not just the presidential contest, but also all the House, Senate, governor. It's all decided by the they're not called members in the United States. They're called people who are registered with the party. And I think that's good because at least you're getting people who, are standing for something. Like, I think the United States is much better off that they selected, somebody, as brave as Trump rather than just, going with a status quo, boring, middle of the road politician.
Yeah, and that's why a more democratic system can actually allow the silent majority, not just in Australian society, but within the Liberal Party itself, to actually have an influence in bringing in more Trump-like figures into it. Remember that Trump won. One major reason Trump won is because he wasn't just anti-establishment; he was still part of a major party, so he was automatically going to get lots of votes from a large percentage of the American people. The thing is, in contrast, people like Pauline Hanson or Marine Le Pen in France or whatever, they are still part of minor parties, and it's still harder for them to get votes because they are minor parties. The major parties automatically do get votes from lots of people, and Trump was able to do that. If Trump was in a minor party, he might not even have won in many ways, and that's something we need to look at. So I think having this system may allow people like Trump to get into the Liberal Party, and then they could use the foundation the party already has, and the support it already has, to actually expand itself and maybe appeal to more people, and then the chances of having a Trump-like figure in Australia as Prime Minister will be increased that way.
And I also want the same sort of democratic system to apply to left-wing parties as well. I mean, even though I disagree with Jeremy Corbyn on a lot of issues, like, I still think it's better that the UK Labour members were able to select him as the leader over the will of the party room, who were overwhelmingly middle of the road. So and. If the Democratic primaries weren't rigged in favor of Hillary, they would have, got an actual, person in Bernie Sanders who, stood for values rather than, somebody as, corrupt as Hillary Clinton.
The thing is, we do have in the Labour Party, Labour Party still has many social conservative members. The Labour right is still pretty conservative. There are people who are very conservative in the Labour right. Just economically, they are more left-wing, I get that. But socially, culturally, they are still very right-wing in many ways. And I think it's important to give them a voice as well. It's going to be beneficial for us in the right as well if they do get more socially conservative people in the opposing party. Win-win for us. I think it's funny because it's funny how Labour in the UK, I was talking about Australia before, funny how Labour in the UK actually have a non-democratic system. They pretend to be a social democrats, they pretend to be proponents of democracy, but within their own party, they don't have a democratic system. I think that's one major sort of one major piece of evidence that shows that they are hypocrites ultimately. I think if they do have the system, it's all better for them as well, and it's going to be much more fairer for them as well.
Well, let's turn to talking about, the Australian Labor Party, I should say. Now, Bill Shorten, he gave a speech to an economic forum on Friday vowing to make inequality the centerpiece of his election campaign. And there's also the discussion this week that the Labor Party wants to target family trusts and tax them more because they're used by, rich, greedy people to hide money. And add to this, I mean, they've obviously already announced their policy reversing negative gearing and also reversing the company tax cuts and restoring penalty rates. So they're going with a very left-wing economic agenda, and they clearly think that the electorate is receptive to such a message in the current economic conditions.
Yeah, I think well, with regards to the last part, I think there are unfortunately for us, unfortunately for this country, there are people who think this current system, current capitalist system doesn't work, and we need a more socialist system, and labor is there conveniently for them. But here is Bill Shorten running around the country telling all these inner city these economists, okay, telling them that inequalities are a problem. I'm pretty sure those economists. I'm hoping those economists were disagreeing with him. He was saying inequalities were a problem, and that it's resulting in, well, it's leading to a disruption in social cohesion, disruption in economic growth. It's funny because when you actually go against this natural sort of aspect of inequality, inequalities are a natural thing, and when you go against that, you actually end up making things worse. I mean, the people in Russia, people in China, people in Venezuela, they found out the hard way. So, here's Bill Shorten ignoring all that evidence, tricking people into voting for him, running around the country saying that, we had to get rid of inequalities. That's just code word for, we need to increase tax on the rich, take more money from people forcefully, and increase spending. This is completely an immoral, and he's a hypocrite ultimately as well when you consider the fact that he isn't complaining about the ABC salaries that are $900,000 a year. Hypocritical, immoral. I'm hoping this person does not become PM next election.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, Bill Shorten's policies are the road to economic ruin. I mean, you don't, tax your way to prosperity. No nation has ever done that. I mean, the reason why we're in this current economic situation is because not because all the rich people are hoarding, all the money, and that all we need is, Bill Shorten to, take it and, give it to, all the poor people. I mean, if Labor actually wants to address the real issues in the economy, they should obviously reverse the climate policies that, their 50% renewable energy target. I mean, that's seen the manufacturing sector leave Australia, and in, the state of South Australia, it's even worse. I mean, it's pushed up the cost of living. I mean, power prices keep on going up, which also increases, the cost of living for all products. So maybe if Bill Shorten's worried about the poor, he should, stop increasing their cost of living.
I mean, it's their regulations that resulted in, people leaving this country in the first place. Thousands of people lost their jobs. Thanks to their regulations, thanks to their, economic blunders. And here he is, again, taking us for a joke, saying, we need to continue doing the thing we've been doing for a while, continue doing the thing that's resulted in all this economic downfall, in this economic stack. Well, not, I wouldn't say stagnation, because Australia is doing relatively well compared to other countries, but it's economic turbulence. Who does he think we are dumb, or does he think that, we can genuinely be persuaded, because if you one look at the past, one look at history, and you will see that these policies do not work. And it doesn't matter, it doesn't even matter if they don't work or not, it's immoral. I mean, he's saying that we need to take more money from people. That's money people earned themselves. They worked hard, they earned themselves, they took the risk, or, well, they either worked hard or took the risk, and they made that money themselves. And here is a Labour Prime Minister, a socialist, telling these people that, your money doesn't belong to you, your money belongs to us and to other poor people, and we will take your money whenever we want and give it to others. All the while, he's ignoring the taxpayer-funded salaries at the ABC, $900,000, or ignoring other things like, it was the Australia Post CEO's, I think it was $4.2 million, I think it was, or in total
It
with
was
the
close to
bonuses as well.
5 million. It was ridiculous.
Yes, yeah. So 4 to $5 million, including bonuses, to the CEO of Australia Post, the former CEO. Ignoring all that, but he is talking about inequalities inside this Melbourne Institute. It's called the Melbourne Institute. I just don't understand. I hope people can see through him and see him for what it is, as a hypocrite.
And there was a quite an interesting article published last week in the Australian Financial Review warning about, as he called it, McManusstan, which, of course, if Bill Shorten becomes Prime Minister, Sally McManus, the new head of the ACTU, and arguably one of Australia's newest regressives, there's quite a lot of them. I mean, she'd be the puppet master, pulling the strings, getting, empowering the unions to, carry out their, criminal and thuggish behavior and really, putting the foot on the neck of, corporations and really, hindering their, ability to try and do business in Australia. And what was really scary about the reaction to that article was that McManusstan was trending on Twitter with all these lefties saying, yeah, that would be like the greatest country on earth to live in.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure eating your own pets is the greatest country, or is the greatest lifestyle you could ever have. People in Venezuela they are eating their own pets. They must actually go to Colombia. They must illegally enter Colombia and go to the grocery stores there to buy their food for cheaper than Venezuela. It's funny because in those countries, you wait for the bread in those countries. In these countries, the bread waits for you. So, if you want to, it's your choice. Do you want to wait for the bread, or do you want the bread to wait for you? Because we already have a country with one of the highest living standards, one of the freest economies in the world, and here you are saying that we need to become a Venezuela. That is completely. I find that quite insulting. You're telling people that you need to become poor because you're jealous and you're insecure about seeing rich people, and that's just, I think that's quite immoral, and that just says everything about the left there is to say.
I certainly, I mean, it's still 2 years away until the next federal election, and this is already what Bill Shorten's come up with on economics. Who knows what else is there? The policies look like they're just going to get worse.
It does, and I think I ultimately blame Malcolm Turnbull for all of this. You might say I'm being unjust, but I think if he was a bit smarter and if he was more if he didn't orchestrate this entire left-wing drift of the Liberal Party, if he wasn't doing any of that, he might actually be able to appeal to lots of people. But thanks to his blunders, people might actually start to appeal to or start to support the Labour Party, because we have seen people saying that Labour must win if the Liberals are to fix itself. Labour needs to win. Well, you can't, because you're gonna have 4 years of Labour in this country. You see what's happening in Victoria right now. So, I do blame Malcolm's incompetence in re that's resulted in this newfound support for Labour.
Okay, so let's move on to talk about Donald Trump's first 6 months in the presidency. So I feel that Trump, he's done all that he can within the power of the presidency through executive order. I mean, he was able to during his first month, implement the travel ban from eight Muslim majority countries, which had a history of Islamic terrorism and links to extremism. It was knocked back by various courts, but luckily the Supreme Court eventually allowed it. He withdrew from the Trans-Pacific Partnership and more recently got out of the Paris Climate Accord. So he, where, when he's got the power to do something, he's made sure that he's been good on his promises. But where he's really hit a roadblock is in Congress, where despite the Republicans having the majority in the House and the Senate, he still can't get his legislative agenda through.
Yeah, I think the executive orders have been one of the greatest tools he has. I think Twitter was the other tool he's used, because he was able to bypass the mainstream media and post his own things and tell the truth. Tell the truth without having the mainstream media do it for him. That was one tool. I think this other tool was, as you mentioned, the executive orders. Because if he chose to do it the normal way and actually use Congress, then many of these things wouldn't even have happened. He was able to deliver on his promises thanks to those executive orders. Yes, we understand that once, well, more than once, various courts actually blocked his travel ban, but thankfully the Supreme Court allowed the travel ban in one way or another, not completely, but it allowed a limited version of the travel ban. But the executive orders have allowed him to get those policies out, and actually help make America great again. Ultimately, there have been blunders, as you mentioned, with the with Obamacare, for example. The Republicans and the Democrats have, for some reason, the Republicans have supported them in keeping Obamacare out, well,
Yeah,
keeping any change out.
the second repeal bill just failed in the Senate, and it's basically
Yeah.
because it's 52-48 in the Senate, and I stole this from another commentator who said like there's two basically like left-wing Republicans in Susan Collins and Lisa Murkowski who don't like Trump and have whatever excuse they want to not vote against him. So it only takes, one other Republican to like, virtue signal and grandstand to say that, oh, this bill isn't perfect. I wanted this, so I'm going to, vote against it to, basically because they want to puff up their own profile and, make Trump, look bad. And so, it basically only takes three Republicans to basically ruin the whole agenda.
And this is why Trump won. This is what people are sick of. These career politicians who are there abusing taxpayer money, abusing their positions, and trying to increase their reputation, try and increase their PR, or try and increase their reputation at the expense of what's in the best interest of the American people. So they're telling American people, hey, I'm going to use this particular moment as my own personal moment of fame and a virtue signal about it. But here you are, you're Americans who will continue to endure the problems you've been enduring for some time regarding Obamacare. Premiums have gone up sometimes by 100%, 200% in some states, and we are here telling you that we want to use this for our own advantage. And I think that is why Trump won. That is what people are sick of, and that's what people have been saying all along. He won because these politicians, these establishment politicians, are corrupt, and they do not have our best interests at heart. I hope he can pass this Obamacare law, because there are people who are paying what they shouldn't be paying for their healthcare, and I think I just hope he can do something about it.
And obviously, we're still waiting for construction to begin on the wall. I mean, that
Yeah.
was a big election commitment that he hasn't fulfilled yet, but that will require legislation and appropriation through Congress. He has put out most people interpreted it as a troll policy to put solar panels on the walls, which would, really trigger the left.
It would. I do know he started the planning stages already. I think he did start examining the areas for the wall and start. He started the planning stages. I am sure. Because I saw on Fox News showing how he was, well, there were people inspecting those areas, and drawing the plans. With the solar panels, I'm actually quite happy with that. Because firstly, because it can troll and it can trigger the lefties. They were marching against Trump on the science march, I think it was. Saying things like there are more than two genders, climate science is real, climate change is real, and this president is, the anti-climate. This president is this villain who's against climate change policy, who's disavowing these climate scientists. I mean, it's funny because our scientists are saying it's not real, but then he is saying that we will have a solar panels fitted to the wall, and I'm hoping it does trigger them. And second, I think it's quite productive as well. If you're going to use that structure in the desert, or in very sort of temperate areas of America, and if you're going to use that for solar panels for energy, I think it's going to be quite productive. I'm hoping we must remember that so renewable energy can be quite regressive, and it can result in increased costs as well. So we're hoping that doesn't happen. We must remember that he must keep in mind those factors as well. But I think it's quite nice to see that he's using the wall not just for protection, but also for other purposes as well. And that's something we expect from this president.
On foreign policy, it's been a bit mixed. I mean, he's like, obviously, ISIS is on the back foot. I mean, they've been pushed out of Iraq, which is good. The Syria strike, was disappointing when it happened, but I think the good thing was that Trump, he learned, from the backlash from his supporters that that was wrong, and so he's taken no further action on Syria. He's, still obviously, being friends with, Saudi Arabia, who spread Islamic extremism around the world. So that hasn't changed, which is disappointing. But probably like the, most important thing that he's done in foreign policy is tried as best he can, given the circumstance, to have friendly relations with Russia.
I think, despite the Russia conspiracies, despite the news stories, the fake news stories that they admitted were fake, and despite all that, I think he has tried to, foster good relations with Russia. I think, in some, it's been both ways. In sometimes he has tried to, be to cooperate with them and actually it worked with them. I know he met with Putin in a very good way, in a very friendly way. Contrast that with Obama, who was just completely stern and completely smug when he met Putin during his presidency. But he has, I think, been quite critical of Russia as well. He has done things, maybe for PR purposes, maybe. He has done things that have condemned them in some ways. I saw today, for example, there was talk about Russia sanctions, and Trump was involved in that, which I thought was quite scary. I'm hoping it's for PR purposes. With regards to Syria, I think it's interesting because we did see various right-wing people who, including us, who are very who opposed that, because that's not something we expected from Trump. We expected him to be a bit more rational, instead of just choosing to strike this airbase that we didn't even know resulted in these alleged chemical bombs. Assad kept denying them. Russia kept supporting Assad, but then the mainstream media loved it. So there was that as well. And with regards to Saudi Arabia, I think that is the biggest issue I have right now with his continued support for Saudi Arabia. He kept saying that Saudi Arabia was a corrupt state. He kept criticizing them during the campaign, during and just before the campaign. And right now, we know that he made a $400 billion arms deal with someone who funds ISIS. I think that's quite scary, and that is the biggest issue I have right now. It's a country that treats people in the most horrendous of ways, and he is trying to foster a relationship with them. I'm not saying we need to intervene in them and change them. I'm saying that we shouldn't cooperate with those countries. So therefore, I think his Saudi Arabia relationship, I think, is the biggest point of concern for me at this stage.
Yeah, it's taking on the neocons in Washington is, especially hard because we've seen, all the deep state leaks against Trump, and so clearly that's a message, you better follow us or, we're going to, bring you down. He has, put up, as you said, put up with all this, fake news about Russia, which has sucked, oxygen. He's got the entire mainstream media against him, and there's always these constant talks about, impeachment. Like some betting agencies have got impeachment odds now, which is like, ridiculous. So, under the circumstance, he's done, quite a lot, despite, he's basically, whacked every day by, Democrats, Republicans, the media, the intelligence community, everybody.
Yeah, we must remember that, America has just it's I say this constantly. America has one party, when it comes to foreign policy. They're all neocons, and the entire establishment has been against Trump with regards to his foreign policy. And I think that's been quite hard. Who knows? Maybe his deal with Saudi Arabia wasn't his own doing. Maybe he had to do it. Maybe that was something he was forced to do by the deep state. We don't know what happens inside the White House. We don't know who he has talked to. We don't know who actually controls him. We know the CIA is powerful, the FBI is powerful. So it might not have been his own decision. So you must re remember that. But I think ignoring all that, it was quite disappointing to see this deal with Saudi Arabia. And I'm hoping he continue. I'm hoping he does estrange himself. I was happy in regards to foreign policy. I was happy with his visit to Poland, where he continued to reiterate the fact that he was there to revive Western civilization, to protect people who live in the West from various forces ranging from the left to Islam to terrorism, who are trying to take the West down, and he reiterated that in front of a war memorial in Poland, quite powerful, and you know I was happy with that.
Yeah, and Steph, I mean, it's only 6 months in. I mean, he was elected to a 4-year term, so there's still if he's accomplished all these things in the first 6 months, then you know there's certainly a lot more to be done, and he's certainly got the time. But let's move on to the next topic, which is it's basically my pet peeve. I mean, every week now I seem to write an article for the Unshackled criticizing the AFL, and the reason I do that is because, you know, I've been a lifelong AFL fan. At the moment, I'm a long-suffering Brisbane Lions supporter. You know, it's something I've grown up with. I love Australian rules, and it's, you know, just makes me so angry that the, you know, AFL governing body is destroying the game through all these, you know, social justice virtue signaling campaigns, basically spending, you know, fans' money, you know, the people who pay the tickets and the memberships on all of these, you know, social issues. I mean, just last weekend they had their gay pride match between Sydney and St Kilda, and this week it's multicultural round, which basically, when they say multicultural, it's basically pro-Islam. I mean, I've been on the AFL multicultural website. There's, you know, like girls with hijabs on it everywhere, and they already promoted Islam through their celebration of Ramadan, the AFL. I mean, it's just relentless.
It is. I think, again, a huge example of why these sporting organizations shouldn't really be going into social justice causes. You know, they should be focusing on their sport. We saw this with companies who are, you know, going into social justice, saying we need to do this. You know, with the rings, the incomplete rings represent, you know, the lack of same-sex marriage, for example, by Qantas. You know, going into straying away from their purpose and going into all these unnecessary things that they shouldn't be focusing on. Ultimately, it's they who will suffer, I think. I'm hoping it's they who will suffer ultimately. These are people who have influence over society, who have influence over our children, especially with the AFL. These are organizations, institutions who have influence over our children. And when they support things that I think, I mean, being nice is one thing, but full on supporting particular things is something else. You know, nothing wrong with being nice, but, you know, going overboard is something that should be concerning, and these can influence our children into doing things they might not want to do. So, you know, I think we need to be careful that with these institutions, they continue to be infiltrated by these left-wing social justice warriors who want to change their branding, change their appearance, and try and appeal to this loud minority and ignore the majority, ignore all of us, ignore us, ignore the normal people. And I think that's it's quite sad, really.
And let's not forget, you know, what happened with their diversity officer, a position which I think shouldn't exist in the first place.
Yeah.
I mean, he king hit somebody on the football field, and the AFL, they stayed silent for a number of days until the tribunal handed down a life ban, and he resigned. Ali Furrah, who we should know is the brother of the Australia Post CEO with the obscene salary, Ahmed Furrah.
Yeah.
Who Australia Post, they sponsored the AFL multicultural program. So in a sense, like Ahmed, he subsidized his brother's salary.
Yeah.
And so the AFL said, like, oh, you know, we accepted your resignation, oh, but, you know, he's a really, you know, like, good guy, and he shouldn't be judged because of these actions. And you remember, of course, one of Australia's, oh, there's so many regressives, Bashir Hooley, Richmond player who king hit.
Yeah.
I shouldn't say king hit. Elbowed somebody in the face. He said that he would trust Ali Fahul with his life, and it was just exposed like hypocrisy. Like, they virtue signal about all these issues, yet when one of their own, you know, does the wrong thing, they, you know, try to protect them as much as possible.
Yeah, I mean, first they have these positions, and they're trying to promote a religion and a political force. It's both. Islam is both. By having these diversity officers and trying to, virtue signal about it and trying to support a religion that has no place in this country. And second, it just got revealed, they got exposed. It just showed that these people are hypocrites and these people are, they pretend to be peaceful, they pretend to be tolerant, but it's next minute it's they who are the ones who are the most violent. Just with the, it's the left. It's the left. That's what you expect on the left. They pretend to be these tolerant, peaceful, compassionate people, but the next minute, the moment you turn your eye and they do something, that moment they start to reveal their true colors. And that is what we've been seeing from the left for all these years, shootings, riots, everything. And, this is just another example in Australia where this is happening. And, just to show that you shouldn't be having these divisive policies in the first place, because you only contribute to, ruining the game's reputation and ruining society's cohesion as well. It's funny, Bill Shorten says that inequalities ruin social cohesion, but it's actually these ludicrous policies and programs that result in a turbulent result in turbulence in society.
And the AFL, they've also got criticism for the forced resignations of two of their executives for having affairs with two, female employees. Most people are saying, well, it's got nothing to do with their, job. Why should they have, had to resign? Like, even though, like, obviously adultery, is immoral and shouldn't be endorsed, but, is it a sackable offence? And I made the point that it seems to be the AFL, they don't like their employees having heterosexual relations, but they seem to be encouraging them to have homosexual relations. And that maybe if these two executives, maybe if they were Muslim taking second wives, the AFL would be okay with
Yeah,
that.
exactly. I mean, again, a religion that promotes not just that, but promotes pedophilia. Okay, its founder practiced pedophilia, consummated a marriage with a girl who was 9 years old. And they promote that, they celebrate that. And I wonder if it was, an Islamic, if two Islamic people who are having, or an Islamic person having an affair, that I'm pretty sure they would have used the religion card, the diversity card, and said, oh, it's Islam, that's how it is. I wouldn't be surprised. And if they did that, then it doesn't matter, because it's exactly what's happening right now, isn't it, with the diversity.
Oh yeah, imagine if they were having like homosexual affairs like that and the AFL sacked them, they'd be accused of
Exactly.
homophobia.
Exactly. That's the society we live in right now.
Right, but the main thing is that sport and politics shouldn't mix. I mean,
Yeah.
I follow politics for a living and like I follow sport to, get away from politics. This is an outlet for me. I
Yeah.
just want to, focus on the football. That's what most people want. We don't, want to be, lectured to, at the football about these, various social issues, especially since the AFL itself can't get its affairs in order.
Yeah, I mean, sport is something, sport and the arts are something that people get to ensure, well, to get out of life and to just escape from life and sort of be happy. We are living in a society that is quite divided in many ways, and sport is there that can help people unite in many ways, but now that these issues are creeping into sport, it's going to make things even worse. And as I mentioned earlier, the game is ultimately going to be ruined if these people, if these institutions are going to ruin continue having these programs, they're just going to ruin the game for the people.
Yep, definitely. Well, that's all we've got time for on today's show. So thank you once again, Suka, for being my co-host.
It was my pleasure.
And as always, the usual reminders apply at the end of the show. If you haven't signed up to the email list, please do so at the unshackled.net subscribe. Please consider supporting the work of the Unshackled by becoming a patron on Patreon. Unless, of course, we get banned from Patreon like Lauren Southern did. We did
Yeah.
publish an article critical of Patreon just this week. So,
Yeah.
yeah, let's hope they leave us alone. We have arranged some awesome benefits for people who support us on Patreon, so make sure you check that out. There's Unshackled merchandise for sale at uprightmarket.com. And don't forget to subscribe to this podcast. You can do so on SoundCloud, iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, or view the video version on YouTube. And of course, don't forget to keep checking the unshackled.net on a regular basis for all the latest news. Thanks once again for listening, and we'll see you next time.